I'd like to begin by telling you a story that I read in the news this week. It's about an American tourist, so everyone in the world's favorite sort of person. So over the American holiday of Thanksgiving, just under 3 weeks ago, that man went on a cruise ship vacation with his family. The boat was called the Carnival Valor, and it was setting sail from Louisiana to the Gulf of Mexico. So the Valor is an 18-year-old conquest ship, that's what it's called, and it's used for shorter cruises and has more amenities. So a casino, a dance floor, multiple pools, multiple bars. So in short, it's known as a party ship. So people get on it for like 2 to 5 days to kind of party. So only hours after the trip started, the 28-year-old man headed to one of the ship's bars with his sister. CNN narrates the beginning of their trip like this. In the first hours after the Carnival Valor set sail from New Orleans on Thanksgiving Eve, a brother and sister set off for a place apropos of a holiday mood. They headed up to an onboard bar. Predictably, the man at one point stepped away to use the restroom, but he didn't come back. Hours passed. He wasn't in his stateroom. The 28-year-old had quite simply vanished. It was around 11 p.m. when the brother walked off, the sister recalled. At noon the next day, Thanksgiving Day, she reported him missing. Announcements echoed through the ship for the missing passenger to check in with guest services, and people noticed security starting to search the boat with a photo of the missing passenger. Around 2:30 p.m. on Thanksgiving Day, the U.S. Coast Guard was told the passenger was missing, and the ship had traveled 200 miles since the man had last been seen. So as I was thinking about that story, I read it late at night. I have lots of trouble sleeping lately, and I've been up reading the news, and that story just appeared, even though it was a bit of a delayed story. And I was thinking about how sometimes we are that man. So we're lost and no one knows where we are, and we feel very alone. And sometimes we're the sister, so someone we know or something we love is lost, and we don't know what to do, so we feel frantic or powerless. And sometimes we're the ship captain. So we've traveled along for 200 miles thinking everything was going great. We've taken off and then suddenly we're taken off our guard, unsure what to do. We're supposed to be leading something, but we don't have good directions for how to lead it. The ship captain doesn't know how to lead a search and rescue. He's not done that before. So as we begin tonight, this is just for yourself. I'd just like us to ask ourselves, who do you relate to? Where do you find yourself? So do you relate to the man who's lost? Do you relate to the sister? Someone or something we know is lost? Or do you relate to the captain? We're supposed to be leading something, but we don't quite know how to do it. Or is there someone else maybe in the story that you relate to as well? So maybe just hold that in mind. We're gonna come back to this story and you'll see the relationship to tonight's text a little bit later. So today's text is a familiar one. It's the salt and light passage from the Sermon on the Mount. So when I got this passage, when Steve kind of mentioned it, I thought, well, this could be interesting, but it's also a text I know really well and probably everybody else knows really well. And so how can it feel fresh or alive or new? So tonight what we'll do is we'll read the text aloud and then we'll look at it from two different perspectives, in hopes that we can see the scripture as fresh and relevant for our lives wherever we find ourselves. So the first perspective is going to be a contextual perspective. We're going to look at the context of the text. And then the second one is going to be a relational perspective. We'll ask the question, what is Jesus doing in this text? So first, the contextual reading. I'll set the scene. So this passage is from the Sermon on the Mount. Some scholars think it was a series of sermons. Thankfully, I have a theologian husband who I can ask for some important context. And he said lots of people think it was a bunch of sermons that were condensed into one. But others think it was one sermon given with a lot of material. But it is key that it was called the Sermon on the Mount. Does anyone know what mount that was on? Does anyone have any idea? I did not before I started reading. Sermon on the Mount. So the Mount is now called the Mount of Beatitudes, so which makes sense. at the time, it wasn't really a mountain at all. Actually, it's still not really a mountain. It was basically a large hill. So a big grassy hill set next to the Sea of Galilee. And the Sea of Galilee is also a bit of a misnomer. So we have the mountain misnamed. The Sea of Galilee is actually a lake. It's not a sea. So it's a very large lake that might have looked like a sea to the first people that were talking about it as a sea, but it's a lake. So we have a mountain that's not a mountain and a sea that's not a sea. And this is part of the context for the Sermon on the Mount. So I'll read on. Okay. This is Matthew 5:13. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. So Jesus gives us a word picture of salt. This is kind of a question for everybody. It's not a group question, but I thought I'd throw it out. When you've heard this passage before, what interpretations have you heard about the salt? Or why it matters.
Everyone's gone to sleep.
Yeah. I'm thinking, for one, it's pointing to, I think, salt's role as like preserving what's good and purifying what isn't.
Yeah, that's great, Taz, for sure. That's a great thought. I mean, I think salt did all sorts of things in Bible times. As Taz mentioned, I mean, it's a preservative. So we don't really use a salt as a preservative anymore because we have refrigerators, but they didn't then. So salt was a preservative, preserved what was good. It added seasoning. Food didn't have a lot of flavor without salt. But it was also used for some kind of weird things that I didn't know about. Until I started reading about it. And one of them was that after a baby was born, they covered the baby in salt, which was intriguing. And they did that to like purify the baby, and because they thought it could kind of get rid of any diseases. Babies were salted, which is a little strange. And then also another interesting use of salt, but a pretty common one, is that when people made promises to each other, they made them eating salt together. They called them salt covenants. So it was generally speaking when friends made promises. So I was thinking about this last night, eating a bag of crisps to use the English word, and thinking, I don't imagine myself eating a bag of crisps with my friend. And I've made like a lifelong commitment through this act. But that is what they did. So salt covenant, you ate salt together, you were making a lifelong commitment to your friend. So kind of a big thing. So there's the salt covenant. So watch out. So salt was a valuable resource. It was really important. So I kind of, as an English professor, I dove a little deeper. Where did salt come from? So during that time, people would pour seawater into big pits, just kind of like giant pools. And then because it's so hot and humid there, the water would evaporate and just the salt would be left. So that's how the salt would came to be. People didn't have to build the salt or make it or come up with it in a lab or anything like that. The salt was already there. So all they had to do was just kind of discover the salt, which is pretty interesting. So I'm gonna go back to the passage one more time. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? So when I read that passage, I again thought, I haven't thought about this very deeply. How does salt lose its saltiness? Can salt become unsalty? And so I had to do some more research to figure out what happens with salt. And it turns out that salt actually can't lose its saltiness. It stays salty. It's a sort of compound that doesn't break down. So what did Jesus mean when he said salt losing its saltiness? How can a salt lose its saltiness? It turns out the only way that salt can lose its saltiness is when it's crowded out by all sorts of other things. So I was thinking about today, if my husband had been home, he's at work, sadly. I was thinking I might do a little test and put give him some salt first, and then put some salt into increasingly different amounts of sugar or other minerals and see, like, can he taste it? You know, when does the salt lose its saltiness? He much prefers salt to sugar. So I thought maybe we'd give that a go. But there's a certain level when the salt is just taken over by the things around it. So other minerals kind of take over. And in the passage, it says, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. So I don't, it sounds like just from our conversation, you guys don't have a lot of snow, some snow. Michigan has tons of snow all the time. So in fact, everyone has to drive a four-wheel drive car because you can't get around if, like, in a little car. They've outlawed smart cars in Michigan because there are too many accidents. So what they do, and maybe this is what they do in England too, I'm not sure, but all winter they put salt on the roads and everyone puts salt on their driveways just to kind of keep things, you know, movable. But there's a lot of discussion about, is the salt really salt? Because Michigan in particular has started mixing the salt with sand because it's a little cheaper, but the sand mixture doesn't work very well. So people on the news and kind of around town are always like checking the colors of the salt to say, the salt might be like, it's a little too off color. And apparently this year, Michigan also used beets. They mixed the salt with beets because they thought, oh, maybe that will work. So all our roads have been turning red, different colors. So we have all these red roads, which has been clear that the salt is not just salt, it's salt plus other things. So that's how the salt loses its saltiness. And the beets and the sand are not as effective at kind of, for us, keeping our cars on the road. So, all right, let me see here. So I would say that's kind of a key kind of context piece for the salt. So let's carry on reading verse 14, okay? 14 says, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. So I thought, okay, I'll take this apart to you contextually. So the first bit is light. So there was no electricity back then. It looks a little like Debs's room looks now, very dark compared to mine, where it's the middle of the afternoon, early afternoon. So what did they have? They had candle flames and firelight. As I was reading, the thing I found interesting though was a single flame, even a tiny little flame, is visible even from a mile away. So that's a kind of interesting note. So we could, you know, you can see light even from far. So next, a city on a hill. So I always assumed this was just a metaphor. And I thought, okay, you know, Jesus is coming up with a good kind of word picture, but actually it wasn't. So does anyone know what cities on a hill were in Jewish tradition? Some of you might've known this, I did not. Anyone have any background on that? My husband knew, but again, he's Mr. Theology. So
Jerusalem is on a hill and it's seen quite far. I see it when I was at Jordan, I could see Jerusalem on the hill.
Hey, yeah, that's awesome. That's great, Katerina. You can see them quite far. So yeah, that's really important. So there were kind of like 9 major cities on hills, and you could see them for ages and ages and ages because they were so high up, which is really key. They were well lit, but they were also known as safe havens. So they were places that anybody could go if they weren't feeling safe. And in fact, they even became safe havens if you accidentally murdered someone, which is kind of a strange phrase, but it's in the Bible. You accidentally kill someone, you go to a safe haven, and you go to one of those cities. And then in the city, people will protect you and say, that's okay, it was an accident, we'll take you in. So the safe havens were kind of a catch-all for people that needed to go somewhere. So when Jesus says a city on a hill, the disciples know this history. It's not a history for them, it's real life. And so they have a sense of a city on a hill being a safe haven, which isn't really what I had thought about before reading this. Okay, just one more piece of context and then the context will be kind of done and we'll move on. But there were also 9 cities around the Sea of Galilee. So remember, we're sitting during the Sermon on the Mount, we're sitting on a large hill overlooking the Sea of Galilee. And the 9 cities there are the lowest cities in the world because they're below sea level, almost like 200 meters below sea level. The biggest one was called Tiberias, which you guys might've heard of before. It's still a city. It's like about maybe 40,000 people now. it was the capital of the area, and it was like 248 meters below sea level. So though Jesus went all over the area, he never goes to Tiberias in the scriptures, which is really interesting and intriguing, because here's this major metropolis and he avoids it. If you kind of want look follow his trail, he doesn't go to Tiberias. And a lot of biblical scholars say it's because the area, the city, was so anti-Jewish. So it had a sports courts, it had a palace, it had a cemetery, which was a problem at the time. The Jewish people didn't like that there was a cemetery in the middle of the town. But it was also known as like kind of a party city. So a little like that cruise ship, the Valor was known as a party place. So was Tiberias, kind of strangely, that's what it was known as. But people from the Jewish people didn't go there because they got such a terrible reception in Tiberias. So as his disciples look out at this famous low city where they are completely unwelcome, Jesus reminds them of these high cities where they can always go, these safe havens. So it's kind of an interesting comparison. So they're literally looking out at Tiberias as he's talking about this, because it's just across the lake, and seeing the low city. And then Jesus is reminding them, hey, what Christians are is a high city. We're not like that low city. We're this high city here, a city of refuge that cannot be hidden. And what is always hidden? A sunken city. Okay, so you don't see the lights from a sunken city from far away. It's not like Katarina's experience of Jerusalem, because it's so low, you can't see it. The city on a hill are what you see high, not the low cities. So I wanted to ask a few questions for our groups. And there are three questions, I'll put them in the chat too. And they're all related to this context. So the first question is there anything crowding out your faith? So thinking about the salt, and how it loses its saltiness by other minerals crowding it out. So is there anything that crowds out your faith that kind of just takes away the time or the energy? So that's the first question. The second question is, what sunken cities do we try to run to? Are there places that we try to hide? So we see in this scripture that these sunken cities are no help for us. And then the third question is, how can we be a refuge for others? Because we see this city on a hill as a refuge. I hope that was helpful. I really appreciated and enjoyed our break room. So I mentioned that we're going to look at this story a couple of ways. So we looked at the context, and the context is that Jesus is with his disciples standing on a hill, or sitting on a hill actually, looking out at this low sunken city, and thinking about this kind of place. And one thing I forgot to mention is there's salt everywhere for these kind of these salt pools. But this also, the area was also known for its hot springs, and they were salt hot springs. They were actually the most famous hot springs in Israel. And they were, you could see them from the hill where they were talking from the Sea of Galilee. So kind of interesting to know that context. So, okay. So for the next kind of way of looking at the scripture, I want to turn a little bit to a kind of relational move. So pretty recently, I was again up late at night, unable to sleep. And I listened to my friend's husband give a sermon. He had given a sermon at my church like 2 years ago. I had no idea. And in the sermon, he said something which struck me. He said, every time we read a story in the Gospels, we should follow Jesus. We should watch actually what he's doing and pay attention and see where is he and what motions and actions is he making, which it seems really obvious. But I don't always do that. I just kind of get a little bit glossed over and I don't pay attention to the actual things that Jesus is doing, not just saying. And so I want us to do that together. So to track what Jesus is doing as we read the text. So to literally watch Jesus. So to watch Jesus in the instance, we have to go back a bit to the beginning of the chapter. So I'm going to read Matthew 15:1, and then I'll read our section again. So now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. So I'll read that one more time. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town or a city built on a hill cannot be hidden. So what did Jesus do? A bunch of people are following him. So he ascends a mountain. I was thinking about this and thinking, if a crowd was following me, what would my response be? My response would be to run and hide. I hate crowds. So I think I would run away as quickly as I could. And then I tried to think about the people in my family. My mother's response would be to dazzle the crowd. She loves a good crowd. And so she would probably try to dazzle them with her wit and humor and whatever else. My dad would be, how can we implement crowd control and fire safety rules? He's very interested in fire safety. Everything has to be safe. So when I was a child, every bedroom in my house had fire safety ladders that you could drop out your window in case of a fire, which we never had a fire or any problems with fire. But I can imagine him trying to corral the crowd and talk to them about fire safety. And then I thought about my husband, my new husband, and he has been a pastor until about 3 weeks ago. And so I think he would say, what a good week. Let's preach now before we lose any congregants. So we better just keep going, you know, move with this kind of momentum. So, but Jesus doesn't do any of these things. We don't see him blocking the crowd or corralling the crowd or trying to preach really quickly before anybody leaves. What we see him do is walk upward. So he moves upward and we assume he lets the crowd follow. So as I was thinking about that, I was thinking, well, what does this say to us? And what I think is this: Jesus takes people on a journey so they can best hear and see truth. So Jesus takes people on a journey so they can best hear and see truth. So why does it matter? Why does he go up? So first, he's talking about a city on a hill. So it might make sense to stand on a hill. So the people are thinking, you know, of the hill. And as I mentioned already, he's talking about salt and he's talking about, you know, we're looking at kind of light. And these metaphors, these figures of speech, these ideas, people could see better up from the hill. Also, they probably could get closer to him. There's more room than there would be at the bottom of the hill, because at the bottom of this hill is the sea. So it's easier for him to kind of be at the top of the hill. So those are important things. But as I was reading the Bible commentaries about it, very few commentators talked about those things. What they tended to say is that mountains are important places in the Bible. And this is a really important truth. So many of the most important truths were spoken on different mountains. And so here we have this mountain for this key truth. So I'm going to read you a little bit of a section from Charles Spurgeon, so the historical Christian writer, what he said on this text. He said, why Jesus takes people up to talk to them. Of course, this would mainly be because of the accommodation which the open hillside would afford to the people, and the readiness with which upon some jutting crag the preacher might sit down and be both heard and seen. But we believe the chosen place of meeting had also its instruction. Exalted doctrine might well be symbolized by an ascent to the mountain. At any rate, let every minister feel that he should ascend in spirit when he's about to decant upon the whole lofty themes of the gospel, a doctrine which could not be hidden and which would produce a church comparable to a city set on a hill, fitly began to be proclaimed from a conspicuous place. A crypt or cavern would have been out of character for a message which was to be published on the housetops and preached to every creature under heaven. Besides, he continues, mountains have always been associated with distinct eras in the history of the people of God. Mount Sinai is sacred to the law. Calvary was also in due time to be connected with redemption, and the Mount of Olives with the ascension of our risen Lord. It makes sense, therefore, that the opening of the Redeemer's ministry should be connected with a mount such as the Hill of the Beatitudes. Okay, so we have Jesus go up the mountain. What does he do next? He sits down. So I was thinking, well, I too might sit down, but that's because I'm in terrible shape and would probably be out of breath from hiking up this big hill to give a talk. But I don't think that's why we see Jesus sitting down. In Jewish culture, teachers sat and pupils stood. So it's an exact reverse of what the American system is, I assume English and German systems as well, where teachers stand and pupils sit. And so Jesus is taking his rightful place as a teacher, and he's giving room for the pupils, the disciples, to gather around him. So he makes space for them to get there. So the second idea I had here was that Jesus makes room for people to join him. So he values people enough to make room for them. So the first idea, again, Jesus takes people on a journey. The second, Jesus makes room for them. And then finally, we see Jesus doing a third thing when you continue reading. Jesus uses ordinary stuff to teach extraordinary truths. So we've already seen the word pictures that Jesus uses, salt and light. Salt and light were really normal elements. They were everyday things. They were super important everyday things, but they were everyday things. So Charles Talbert describes these as verbal icons. An icon is often like a picture that people look at as a representative of God. But he says these are verbal icons. So in a culture without social media or books or YouTube, people needed ways of remembering. And so Jesus gives them ways of remembering through these pictures. But the ways that he picks are important. So Talbert goes on to add that these pictures give us a glimpse of the divine intent for our lives. They can shape our dispositions, our motivations, and our way of seeing the world. So some things I noticed. Neither salt nor light is created by people. It can be hidden by them, but they don't have to make it. God does. That's the first thing. Second thing, salt and light are necessary to survival. They matter, even though they were ordinary. Sometimes we think we have to be extraordinary to be used by God. We have to create our own light. We have to be light. And for me, at least, sharing my faith can become less about letting people gather and see Jesus with me. And instead it can feel like I need to be like have the perfect words or be the perfect person. I need to be this city on a hill. I need to be the light itself. Sometimes people feel that only highly gifted speakers can talk about Jesus. Or worse, only highly gifted people can come to Jesus. But when we watch Jesus, we see that it's all backwards. We are the ordinary stuff here, and Jesus uses us. So we see him using us, the ordinary. So when we look at this passage following Jesus, we see that Jesus takes people on a journey, Jesus makes room for people to gather, and Jesus uses ordinary stuff to teach extraordinary truths. So I'm going to ask three questions. I'll put them in the chat again, and we'll go back into our group for another 10 minutes. So first, is there a time you can think of when God has taken you on a journey in order to learn a truth? So he didn't just teach you the truth, he made you go on a journey to learn it. Second, is there someone ordinary God has used in your life? And third, how can we make room for people to gather around and see Jesus? Okay, I'll put these in the chat. So three questions, and we'll take a few more minutes and talk. We've just kind of recap. We've looked at salt and light in their context. The light relating to the city on the hill as a refuge, and the salt as being a valuable resource, but ordinary that God uses anyway. And the only way we can lose our saltiness is if the salt is corrupted by other things. I want to get back to that story I started with, the story of the American tourist on the boat. So if you weren't here, there was an American tourist that that disappeared off a boat or on a boat in the Gulf of Mexico over Thanksgiving of this year. And when we stopped the story, it was 2:30 p.m. on Thanksgiving Day, and the U.S. Coast Guard had just been called. So after the Coast Guard, all the boats in the Gulf were alerted there may be a man overboard. So if you think about that, the Gulf of Mexico is huge. So this is probably thousands of boats that were alerted to look for this person. Helicopters began to scan the area and airplanes. And the Carnival Valor, the ship, turned back from its route to Mexico to try to find the man. But it had been a long time. And the ocean is a very big place. So for 1 hour, then 2 hours, 3 hours, nothing happened. The ocean just normal. And suddenly around 8:30 p.m., a boat crew from a carrier was looking out at the water when they saw something. And it was a man, and he was wildly waving his pants in the air. And that is pants in the British term. He had taken them off and was waving them around above the water. He wanted to be seen, that's why. And so he thought, I'll put my pants in the air and wave, wave, wave. So 18 hours after he had slipped overboard, a helicopter came and pulled the man to safety. So the man showed signs of shock, hypothermia, and dehydration, but he was still alive. Amazingly, like we were calling it in the US a Thanksgiving miracle, because they couldn't think of anyone that had survived that long in the water. So I'm going to read a quote from the ship captain. He said, "The fact that he was able to keep himself afloat and above the surface of the water for such an extended period of time is just something you can't take for granted, and certainly something that will stick with me forever." So when the man got out of the hospital, he began to give interviews. And this is how I saw him. I just saw an interview that he was giving and then tracked down the story. He didn't really remember how he'd fallen over the boat. He had drank a lot of alcohol before this happened. What he did recall was, because the water was salty, he was able to float. So in that salty water, he remembered himself floating. And then when things were at the worst, in the middle of the night, and he was swimming alone for hours and hours and hours, he saw a light in the distance. And he knew that if he could just get to that light, he would find his way home. So that's what he said. Salt in this. So it's kind of interesting to see that here, you know, he's not a Christian, and he's not, you know, thinking in a biblical way, but even so, God, you know, sets this metaphor up for all these people that are reading CNN news. Suddenly there's salt and light. And I thought, I wonder who's catching this, or, you know, who's noticing this, that, you know, here he is telling us that it was this salty water that he felt okay in. He was able to just kind of rest in. And then this light that he saw that kept him hopeful that he could get back to shore. And so he just waited until the light got closer, and that's when he kind of waved around. And then it was the boat. So they came and found him. So just returning back to the very start of this, message today. So we thought about people we relate to. So sometimes we related to the lost man that was overboard and didn't know if people were going to find him. And sometimes we related to the sister who felt frantic when he disappeared. And sometimes we related to the captain who didn't know what to do. And in all of these instances, the sister and the man and the captain all said it was a miracle. And they all use that term, miracle. It was something that could only be ascribed to. And so God himself was the one that rescued and pulled this man out of the darkness. And I think for us too, if we find ourselves lost, or someone we know is lost, or we're supposed to lead something and we don't know what to do, I think God is there too. And ultimately, he's our refuge, and he is who that we can run to. So we don't have to be the salt or the light. We just have to open ourselves up to God and gather people, let people gather around and meet Jesus with us. So I'm going to pray, and then whatever is next, Steve can kind of take it. Just an open time to chat. But okay, let me pray. Dear God, I thank you for everyone that's here today in this group. I pray that if anyone feels lost, that you will seek and find them, and they'll know that you are with them. I pray for anyone who knows someone who's lost. We probably all know someone who's struggling. Give us hope and wisdom, God, to know how to help, and to know when to ask you to help, God. And I pray for the ways in our lives we find ourselves surprised or without directions, not sure what to do. I pray that you'll swoop in like you did with the man and create a miracle, God. And he did that salt and light in his case. But I pray too for those ordinary elements, the salt and the light, that you will make us the salt and the light of the world for being that in us. So I just pray that you'll bless each of these people as we go forward today. Amen.